I just put my mask, even though it sounds
weird.
Students and teachers, this is a tardy suite. If you're not in class, just go straight to the covered eating area. All students, please go to the covered eating area if you are not in class. Teachers, we'll try to make this quick. On another hand, another note, I was 9-0 in ping pong today on the quad. That was a lot of fun. Thank you very much. If I'm ever up there again, you see me, you guys feel, come on by and challenge me. I'll take on anybody, anytime. And again, this is a tardy suite.
All right, now that we are past the last unit exam, I have some information. Class from this point forward, all the way until the end of the year.
You said I can't figure it out.
Okay. Don't fall apart on me now. Seniors, don't give in to the temptation. The end of the school year is fast approaching. The final exam for this class is a unit exam. It is not a cumulative final. It covers the material presented in class from this point forward. A lot of material is going to be covered, however, in this class as we approach the end of the year. If you fall apart now, you run the risk of failing the final exam. The final exam is worth 200 points. Final exam, in part, is designed to test whether or not a student pays attention for the remainder of the semester. Now, many of you are going to be taking AP exams over the course of the next 2 weeks. This class doesn't stop or pause during AP exams. We keep going. You're responsible for all of the material that is presented over that period of time. Now, if you have to miss class legitimately, of course, for an AP exam, or if you're prepping for an AP exam, that's fine, but just be aware that you're responsible for everything. So we are making sure that all the lectures from this point forward basically are going to be filmed. If you would like to attend one of the other periods, however, as a makeup, that's perfectly fine. Right now, the regular and honors classes are identical. So if you couldn't be here in the afternoon, for example, for period 6, you could be here in the morning, perhaps for periods 2 or 4, or the previous day. For regular physics, periods 1 and 3, as I said at this moment, the classes are identical. Over the next 2 weeks, no laboratory exercises are going to be done. So you're not going to miss a lab if you are absent for an AP exam. All of the mini lab exercises, there's actually 5 of them, we're going to do well towards the end of May as we approach the end of the year. I also find it necessary at this time to remind you about grade grubbing. Grade grubbing is that ill-advised practice of going to a teacher to beg for a higher grade. Don't do that. It reflects very badly on your character. If you tell your parents to do that on your behalf, it makes them look really bad as well. So keep it together. Don't fall apart on me between now and the end of the year, and you're going to be just fine. Take a look here at the back side. Okay, this is an aid for you as you start to get a handle on where you're going to be at the end of the semester. This right here is all of the remaining points that we have here for the class. Decent point, Jason. Vision. So first of all, there are going to be 52 points worth of WebAssign left. The mini lab exercises towards the end of the day, there's 5 of them. 5 times 15 is 25. We're also going to see 3 films between now and the end of the year, and an additional assignment will go along with that for a total of 40 points, and then the final exam itself is worth 200 points. So at this point in the class, you have an understanding of what's to come, you can figure out ultimately what is possible and what is not possible. And then lastly, those of you that helped me out earlier this semester with my presentations, I've not forgotten about that, don't worry. If you wanted to help out with my presentations but you weren't able to do so, and you wanted that last opportunity for extra credit, I haven't forgotten about that either. That doesn't come, however, until close to the end of the year. Are there any questions here about essentially the remainder of the course? Yes, Ariel?
Do you know how many points that extra credit is going to be?
15. Okay. Anything else? Yes?
If we're coming during one of the other periods, mm-hmm.
You will have to clear an absence, perhaps, from your other teacher. So if you wanted to come during period two, for example, you would have to get permission from your period two teacher to do that ahead of time. That's fine. And then you would just come in and sit towards the back. Period two, by the way, is a much larger class than this. There's 39 students in that class. So it's nearly filled. But the other periods, period four, and also the previous day, periods one and three, those are about the same size as this class. There's space available for this. Okay? Anything else? Okay, very good. Go ahead and put this aside, please. The rest of the year starts now. Okay, light has a wave. So back in our previous unit, of course, we studied mechanical waves. Now, when I say the word mechanical, I mean that we're talking about the wave that is propagating through an elastic medium. So, for example, seismic waves propagating through rock, sound waves propagating through air, and so on. Recall some of the basic properties that we looked at over the course of that last unit of mechanical waves. Reflection. Refraction and interference. In one form or another, we examined some of the basic properties of mechanical waves in our last unit. Now, as you may or may not be aware of, light exhibits these properties as well. So a couple of short demonstrations here. For example, first of all, reflection. Right here is a piece of what is called a plane mirror. A plane mirror is where the mirrored surface is completely flat, and everybody here, of course, is familiar with their image in a plane mirror. Exactly how images are formed in mirrors using what is called the law of reflection, we'll get to a little bit later on. Not only will we learn about how you form images with plane mirrors, but also with curved mirrored surfaces. Convex mirrors and concave mirrors. We'll get to those details a little bit later on. But for now, the basic simple principle that governs then how images are formed in mirrors is what's called the law of reflection. I'll go through that in detail a little bit later on, but let me first of all just demonstrate it to you. I'm going to demonstrate it to you in the following way. I'm going to use a laser pointer here. Let me first of all make the room dark. And the laser pointer itself is a very low wattage. And if I just turn it on, you can see the beam, or see the spot of light, rather, there on the ceiling. And now what I'm going to do is just shine the beam here onto the mirror, like so, and it then gets reflected here off to the side, like so. Now, you can't actually see the beam of light itself for a couple of reasons. Number one, this is a really cheap, made in China, low wattage laser. So the amount of energy per second necessary to produce the light here is very small. So in other words, it's very dim. In addition to that, in order for you to be able to see the beam itself would have to reflect off of something. There's nothing here in this space for the beam to reflect off of, so that's why you don't see it. But you do see its effect when it eventually reflects off the mirror to the ceiling above. In order for you to be able to see the beam, what I could do is take a little bit of chalk dust and then kind of do something like this. Like so. And there's the incident laser beam, like so. And then right over here off to the side. And too much chalk on the mirror. There we go. right over here off to the side a little bit, you can start to see the reflected beam then coming off like so. But this is a very cheap low wattage laser. Obviously, it's not very good. But what you're seeing here is a simple illustration of what is called the law of reflection. Okay, then, a couple of basic simple demonstrations involving now refraction. I'm going to pass around to you guys a couple of different things for you to take a look at. Okay, first of all, it's just a beaker of water with a pencil that's immersed in it. And when this comes to you, I want you to look for a couple of things. First thing to look at is to just look at the beaker side on like so. And when you do, look at where the pencil intersects the water. It almost looks as if the pencil is broken. You'll see the pencil kind of like this in the air. Then it appears to be jagged in some manner and then goes like this into the water. The reason why you're seeing this is because there is a change in the direction of the propagation of light as it propagates from the air to the water to the glass and then back to the air again. When light passes through different materials, it changes speed. Remember that when a wave changes speed, that then results in a change in the direction of propagation. We saw this, for example, with water waves. As they speed up or slow down by crossing a boundary, they change the direction of propagation. Then you can also see refraction in the following way with this simple demonstration. Instead of looking at the beaker side on like so, kind of hold it like this and look at it obliquely and look to see where the pencil here intersects the water. When you do, the pencil appears to be bent. You'll see the pencil kind of like this in the air and then kind of like this in the water. There appears to be a change in the direction as well. Once again, you're seeing refraction here, a change in the direction of propagation of light waves as the light propagates from the air to the water to the glass and then back to the air again. So take a look at this in a couple of different ways. As it gets passed around to you, don't drink the water. Okay, a couple of other neat refractive effects. Okay, right over here is a cube made of a really hard type of plastic called acrylic. Acrylic is especially refractive. When this comes to you, kind of orient the cube in different directions and at different angles as you look at it. And when you do, you're actually going to see multiple images of corners of the cube within the cube itself. You're ultimately seeing a change in the direction of propagation of light as it propagates from the air to the acrylic and then back to the air again before it finally enters your eye. You can also see the refraction here with this acrylic cube by doing the following. Look across the room at somebody like so, straight through the cube, and then kind of tilt the cube like this to the side. If you do this kind of rapidly back and forth like so, when you see the image of the person on the other side of the room, that person is going to appear to shift a little bit. You're once again seeing a change in the direction of propagation of the light as it passes through the cube. So take a look at that. Okay, here's another example of more or less the same thing. This glass cube right here, however, has this added feature of a hole dug into the side of it. So when you once again hold this glass cube now at different orientations or at different angles, you can actually see multiple images of the hole here inside the cube. If you put your finger in the hole like so, you'll notice that the image here of your finger is actually smaller than your finger. What happens when light refracts across a curved surface? We'll talk about later on as we start to work towards understanding how lenses work. But this is just another example of refraction here. Take a look at this as well. Now these are simple, cute demonstrations of both reflection and refraction, but kind of the coup de grace, if you will, that definitively shows that light is a wave, is interference. Today you're going to look at a specific interference pattern. I'm going to show it to you with light a couple of different ways, but it turns out to be the exact same interference pattern that you saw briefly at the end of chapter 15 when I was talking about two-source interference. And remember, I set this up in my ripple tank. I had two point sources of circular water waves tapping the water together in unison. Circular wavelets then propagated outwards through the water from those sources. Those waves encountered one another, and they then produced an interference pattern. I'm not going to reproduce it here in the water tank. I'll instead show you that happen that I showed you originally as well a couple of weeks ago. Remember how this happen worked? Okay, down at the bottom here of the Atwood, I have two sources here that are very close together. And I'll just go ahead and set this into motion. So, waves then propagate opposite. So, from the two sources, they then encounter one another. You guys all right?
Yeah, I'm just like...
Okay, I know, it's kind of weird the first time you see it. Okay, all right. But the waves then propagate outwards from the two sources, they encounter one another, and they then start to interfere with each other. So you end up with this very distinctive pattern of nodes and antinodes. Remember the nodes, for example, say these lines right here, and that's where the water is completely flat. Remember what happens in that situation. You have a crest from one wave, completely overlapping a trough from the other. The two waves then completely cancel each other out, and the water is flat. That then results in a node. And then right in between the nodes, say right here, for example, where the wave is really big, that's an antinode. That's where you have a crest from one wave overlapping a crest from another. So you get a really big crest. Or alternatively, that's where you have a trough from one wave overlapping a trough from the other, and you get a really deep trough. So you end up with this simple pattern that kind of alternates as you go from left to right here in the applet of antinode, node, antinode, node, antinode, node, and so on. And now what I'm going to do is I'm going to show you the exact same pattern, but in this case, it's going to be in terms of light. Here's how I'll do it. Let me direct your attention here to the back of the room. Yeah, I'm going to use this laser here in just a moment, but then when I do, I'm going to shine the laser here onto this card. And onto this card here, there are a number of different what are called slit arrangements. In particular, what I'm going to do is shine the laser light on two very closely spaced vertical slits. They're holes that are basically vertical like so. And the slits themselves are really close together. They're less than a millimeter apart. And then we'll see then their effects on the far wall, the whiteboard in the front of the room. Now let's just kind of think ahead of time about what it is that we would expect to see. In other words, if you shine a light on the two holes and you then look across the room, what would you expect to see? Just say two spots of light. No, you see an interference pattern. Okay, now those of you that are, by the way, in this seat here, you may have to kind of duck down a little bit as I set this up. And then, Jacob, if you could do me a huge favor and turn off the lights for me. Like so. Right here on the far wall is now an interference pattern. It will kind of bring it closer to you. I'm going to do that by... random folder here and doing this. Kind of like so. And then notice that you don't see two spots of light. In other words, what you're seeing here in interference pattern is actually an alternating pattern of nodes and antinodes. The points where it's very bright, those are regions of total constructive interference. Those bright fringes, as they're called, are antinodes. But then right in between the antinodes, say right here for example, notice that there's actually no light at all. The reason for that is because that's a region of total destructive interference. The dark fringes, as they're called, those are basically nodes. So you end up here with the exact same pattern as what you're seeing on the applet. It's an alternating pattern of antinode, node, antinode, node, antinode, node, and so on as you go from one side of the pattern to the other. Now it is, as I said, the exact same pattern as what it is that you're seeing on the applet. But why does it look like this as opposed to this here in the tank? A couple of reasons. Number one, the light itself is really dim. In order for you to be able to see the laser light here in the room, I would have to like rain chalk dust down from the ceiling or something like that. Okay, I'm not gonna do that. But then secondly, and most importantly, the reason why you can't see the waves with the light is because the speed of light is enormous compared, for example, to the speed of water waves here on this applet. These guys here are only moving at speeds of a few centimeters per second, so you can easily see the waves themselves. In the case of light, it travels at the speed of light, a fundamental constant that I'll describe to you in a little while. That constant has a value of 3 times 10 to the 8th meters per second. So you can't see the individual waves of light here in the room for that reason. Instead, what you're seeing is the effect of all of those waves as they pile up on the screen here in the front of the room. In other words, when you see, look at the whiteboard, you're basically looking at this side of the pattern. You're seeing an alternating pattern of antinode, no, antinode, no, anti-node, and so on as you go from one side to the other. A demonstration such as this definitively shows that light is a wave. This particular demonstration, by the way, is a very famous experiment that was first done in the early 19th century. It's called Young's experiment, and what Young's experiment is designed to do is it's designed to measure the wavelength of light. Young's experiment, by the way, will be one of the mini lab exercises that you do. You'll perform the experiment. It's easy to do. We'll do that, however, towards the end of May. Okay, before we get to the details of the experiment itself and so on, one thing, however, that I want to briefly cover first, I want to give you a basic understanding, just qualitatively, of exactly what light is. Let me turn this off. So, what is the nature of light as a wave? Well, light, as we're beginning to see here, is a wave, but it's unlike any other wave that we know of in nature. All other waves are mechanical waves. That is, a disturbance that propagates through an elastic medium. Seismic waves through rock, sound waves through the air, and so on. Light is a wave, but it's unlike any of those other waves. Light is instead what is called an electromagnetic wave. Now, I do not cover electricity and magnetism in this class, nor is it covered in the regular class as well. The reason for that is because in order to go through the mathematics of the laws of electromagnetism, it involves some rather advanced mathematics. So we save it basically for AP. It's an AP topic. I'm sure that your colleagues in AP Physics will tell you horror stories right now all about that portion of the course. But even still, getting a handle of the basics of what light is as an electromagnetic wave is actually fairly simple and straightforward. Here's how I'm going to begin to describe it to you. I'm going to show you a demonstration here that everybody in this room has seen before in some previous class. I'm going to start with a simple demonstration of the electric force. So I'll demonstrate it to you here in the following way, that is the electric force. I'm going to take this plastic rod here and I'm going to rub it up like so it's a rabbit fur. The reason why I'm doing this is because there's a lot of friction associated with the rabbit fur when I do this. When I do this, and now we understand this perfectly well today. Nicole, stay with me. Remember the handout. We understand this perfectly well today. Whenever matter comes in contact with other matter, there is a transfer of electrons from one material to another. In the case of plastic and the rabbit fur, when I rub the plastic with the rabbit fur like so, I am literally tearing electrons out of some of the outermost electron shells of the atoms that make up the plastic and transfer it to the rabbit fur. This always happens to some degree whenever matter interacts with other matter. So even when I walk across the floor like so, and there's friction between my feet and the floor, there is a little bit of transfer of electrons back and forth between the materials. Most of the time that transfer is so small that you never notice it. However, in the case of this plastic, when I do rub it up with the rabbit fur like so, I actually transfer electrons from the plastic to the rabbit fur. Now, the protons in atomic nuclei, they're basically locked up in atomic nuclei. They don't transfer at all. It's only the electrons that do transfer. So then, therefore, if I remove electrons from this plastic rod, but it still has the same number of protons as it had before, what overall electric charge does it now have?
Positive.
Yes, it has a positive electric charge because I've taken away some electrons. So I'm going to give this plastic rod like so positive charge, place it here on my hanger. This hanger, by the way, forms a type of pendulum. And now I'm going to do the exact same thing with this identical plastic rod. I'm going to go ahead and rub it up and give it a positive charge. And then, as everybody here in this room knows, what happens when you bring like charges together? They repel each other. There it is, that side. Like so. So what you're seeing there very simply is a simple demonstration of the force of what is called electrostatic repulsion. Now, as your colleagues, as I mentioned, in AP Physics will tell you, it's very difficult to watch a demonstration such as this and then transfer what you saw as a demonstration to a diagram on the board and the mathematics that are then used to describe the situation itself. With regards to this difficulty, physicists are very adept at coming up with mental pictures or mental scaffolding, if you will, of trying to visualize very difficult effects, such as what you would see in electromagnetism. Take a look at that poster of that gentleman below the clock. That guy there is a man named Michael Faraday. Without his work in the 19th century, all of this stuff that we all rely on so much, none of this is possible without Faraday. Faraday was a genius, but he was very poorly educated. He came from basically a very poor background. His formal education ended when he was only in grade school. To compensate for his lack of formal education, however, and his poor knowledge of mathematics as a result, he comes up with a mental way of essentially visualizing the forces of electricity and magnetism, which we then actually still use today. He conceives of the idea of what is called a field. Here's the basic idea behind what is known as an electric field. Think of it like this. Okay, let's say that I've got a proton here, a positive charge, and it's nailed in place, it can't move. And then let's say that I bring another positive charge close to this one. Let's say that I bring another proton, say, right over here. Well, remember that like charges repel. So this second proton is going to get repelled in this direction. If I take that second proton and put it here, it's going to get repelled in this direction, and so on and so on. So Faraday comes up with a way of visualizing this proton's force on another proton as a series of what are called field lines. The field lines themselves are vectors. It's drawn out simply in the following way. Like so. Now what these field lines represent is it represents this proton's force on another proton. So for example, if I put a second proton right here, it would get repelled in this direction. If I put that second proton here, it would get repelled in this direction, and so on. Here's another way of thinking about this. Let's think of it in the context, in this case, of gravity. Let's say, for example, that I'm just standing here in this room, and I take a marker, and I put it right here at this point in space, and I let go of it, and it accelerates downwards. We, of course, know why this is now. The force of gravity is exerted upon it due to the Earth. If I take that marker, however, and put it here at this point in space and do the same thing, the exact same thing happens. The force of gravity is exerted upon it due to the Earth, and it accelerates downwards. What if I wanted to represent the Earth's gravity, however, here in this room, without even bothering to talk about the marker itself? Well, I can visualize the Earth's gravity in this room as a vector field, a series of vectors, field lines, that are all pointing vertically downwards here in this room. In other words, it's a way of describing the Earth's gravitational force without even bothering to have to talk about the marker. Same idea here. The electric field is visualizing this proton's electric force on a second proton without even bothering to have to talk about the second proton. So it's an easy way of just visualizing the electric force associated with this proton here in space. By the way, I have to explain something about this. Okay, I forgot one more field line, like so. Hey, now, Faraday just comes up with this idea as a mental means of picturing everything. It was basically his own imagination at work. The brilliance of his idea, however, is that the field itself actually physically exists. And I could show it to you in the following way.
He just made it up, just had to be true.
No, that's not quite how it worked out. You may have seen this device before. This device here is referred to as a Van de Graaff generator. It's named after somebody. And the Van de Graaff generator, after I plug it in and turn it on, actually is able to generate a large amount of electric charge here at its surface. It actually builds up a huge amount of electrons here at the surface. Let me just go ahead and turn it on. And it takes a few moments here to charge it up. And now, under the right conditions, you can actually see the field lines associated with the Van de Graaff generator. And if I take some bits of the rabbit fur, for example, and tear some of it, like so, and now just place it close to the generator. Like so. And if you look carefully at the rabbit fur, notice that the rabbit fur is starting to trace out the diagram that I have on the top board. It's starting to line up with the field lines, the electric field associated with the charge on the Van de Graaff generator. So Faraday comes up with the idea, it's just a means of picturing things and that's all, but it turns out that the field itself literally exists. And you're starting to see it, if you will, in the following way. The rabbit fur is basically lining up with the field lines themselves. And it turns them off. So. All right, now what does this have to do with light? As brilliant as this idea by Faraday is. Now, keeping in mind this diagram still on the board, let me ask now the following question. What would happen? If the electric charge was accelerated in some manner. For example, say set into oscillation. What I've drawn here on the board is just a stationary proton, basically the Van de Graaff generator standing still on my desk. With the rabbit fur, you can start to see the field lines themselves. Well, what would happen if we took that proton, say, and accelerated it in some manner? Say, for example, set it into oscillation. Well, the following happens. So right in the center of this animation, that red dot is basically my proton here on the board, and then in black are the field lines themselves. Once again, you sort of see the field lines with the rabbit fur. And now watch what happens if this proton, for example, is set into oscillation. Like so. Notice that a disturbance propagates that field. That disturbance is an electromagnetic wave. How magnetism is wrapped up into all of this, that's a long story. Your colleagues in AP Physics, I'm sure, could tell you horror stories about it. But if you take an electric charge and set it, for example, into oscillation, the disturbance propagates through the field. The speed of that disturbance through the field in a vacuum is one of nature's fundamental constants. It's the speed of light. 3 times 10 to the 8 meters per second. That's what light is. It's an electromagnetic wave that propagates through this field if you take an electric charge and accelerate it in some manner. Now, how you accelerate the charge, in other words, how much energy you put into the process, that then determines the type of light you get. So, for example, if you set this into oscillation with a really low amount of energy, it's just kind of oscillating up and down like so. It then creates an electromagnetic wave that has a really long wavelength and then therefore a very small frequency. That's a radio wave. If, for example, you instead take the electric charge and set it into oscillation like so with a high amount of energy, then it has a very short wavelength associated with it. It has a very high frequency and then therefore it's a very high energy form of electromagnetic radiation. That's a gamma ray. But in between gamma rays and radio waves, you have the continuous, what is called electromagnetic spectrum. When I draw it out for you here on the board in just a few moments, keep in mind it's all basically the same stuff. The only thing that changes from one type of light to another is alternatively the wavelength, the frequency, and the energy necessary to create it in the first place. So here's a brief summary of all of that. That is, first of all, the answer to this question. Disturbance propagates through the field. That's an electromagnetic wave. Okay, the speed of that disturbance is one of nature's fundamental constants. The speed of that disturbance in a vacuum. One of nature's fundamental constants. A very important number in this class going forward to the end of the year. And that's the speed of light, called c. The value of c is enormous. It's 3 × 10⁸ meters per second. That's 300,000 kilometers per second. That's 186,000 miles per second. If you could, for example, move at the speed of light, which is impossible to do for reasons that you'll see later, you could go around the Earth, for example, 7 times in 1 second. You could travel, say, from the Earth to the Moon in about 1.5 seconds. You could travel, say, from the Earth to the Sun in about 8.5 minutes. That's basically what the speed of light is. The type of light that you get, however, as I mentioned a few moments ago, that has to do with the amount of energy that is put into the process to begin with. So the type of light results from the energy. And now that type of light, this huge continuous spectrum called the electromagnetic spectrum, is drawn out a couple of different ways. It really doesn't matter which way you draw it, but here's how I'll go about doing so. The EM spectrum. And we can draw it from left to right or vice versa. It really doesn't matter. Well, let me start over here. First of all, the gamma rays. Ultraviolet, and then the visible portion of the electromagnetic spectrum. The visible portion of the electromagnetic spectrum is only a very small slice of the overall continuous electromagnetic spectrum. Every color that you see corresponds to a slightly different wavelength. And probably everybody here in this room, by the way, has memorized at one point or another the order of colors in the visible portion of the spectrum. We use a little mnemonic to describe it. Does anybody know what it is?
Roy G. Biv.
Yeah, Roy G. Biv. So I actually have it kind of backwards, by the way, here on this diagram, because red light has a bigger wavelength than orange light, then yellow, green, blue, indigo, violet. And then, to the right to continue, we have infrared, microwave, and then radio. If, as I said, I've drawn your spectrum from left to right, what this means is that as you go in this direction, the wavelength increases. Okay, now, for all of this different type of light, it's all basically the same thing. That is, it all has the same speed c, the speed of light in a vacuum. Speed is equal to the wavelength multiplied by the frequency. So if to the right-hand side the wavelength increases, this means that to the left-hand side the frequency increases. So the frequency increases in this direction on my diagram. And the energy necessary to produce the light, that also increases to the left here on the diagram as well. We could have, by the way, just as easily have drawn the diagram backwards. Either way, it's perfectly fine. Okay, let me give you a basic understanding as where this different type of light comes from. For the most part, in ultraviolet, visible, and a little bit into the infrared, most of this light right here is produced when electrons transit back and forth between energy levels within atoms. When atoms are excited, they emit light. when they quote cool down, they absorb light. That usually all happens within these portions here of the electromagnetic spectrum. The reason why our eyes evolved the way they did, so we can see the Roy G. Biv, is because the sun is actually brightest in the visible portion of the spectrum. That's why our eyes evolved the way they did. Within the animal kingdom, some animals can see a little bit into the infrared beyond what we can see. Some can see a little bit into the ultraviolet, but for the most part, all the animals worldwide are basically looking at this. Now, we sometimes use the word heat synonymously with infrared radiation, and the reason for that is as follows. Okay, remember what heat is from the first semester. It's basically the random vibrations of atoms and molecules. We talked about that as far back as talking about friction, for example, in chapter 5. But when atoms and molecules vibrate at normal temperatures, they emit infrared radiation. You can't see it, but it's there. They emit that light. We sometimes call that light heat as well. Okay, then, into the microwave band here of this portion of the electromagnetic spectrum, this type of light is very easy to produce with electric circuits. So technologically, for example, wireless communications, all this junk right here, that's produced with microwave radiation. And then longer wavelength still, Aaron, stay with me. Longer wavelength still is the radio portion of the spectrum. In nature, typically very cool objects emit radio waves, like gas clouds in between stars and stuff like that. And then to the left-hand side, as you move increasingly to the left, the energy necessary to produce the light increases. So at this extreme end with gamma rays are only produced in nature with the highest forms of energy. Like, for example, with nuclear reactions. So in the core of the sun, when nuclear fusion occurs, some of the energy is released as gamma ray radiation. Also, when a nuclear bomb explodes, some of the energy is released as gamma rays, or even like really exotic processes, like black holes colliding and stuff like that, you get huge amounts of release of radiation as gamma rays. But all of it is basically the same stuff in the sense that it's a disturbance that propagates through the field. That disturbance is electromagnetic. Let me take a short break here. Tomorrow, don't sleep.
Oh, it's really friendly.
just went down a water slide.
Oh.
That's probably
shows that light is a wave. The experiment itself is designed to measure the wavelength of light. Sometimes, by the way, just generically, it's referred to as the double slit experiment. Designed to measure wavelength for light. Okay, now it turns out we actually have gone through the experiment. Did so when talking about what happens for the two-source interference pattern involving, for example, the ripple tank of water. So before we revisit that here, there are some terms that are defined. Okay, first of all, we kind of define things in the following way. There's a typical diagram that goes with the actual experiment. We first of all draw the two slits like so. There's a vertical slit here. And there's a vertical slit here, like so. The spacing between the slits is very tiny. It's an experimental control, and that spacing is called D. It's an experimental control in the sense that you set it up ahead of time. Okay, now immediately there's a little bit of confusion here, however. Is the distance D from here to here, or is it, say, from here to here? Well, all that we have to do is we treat each individual slit as a point. So it's just the distance from one point to the other. We don't consider the actual width of the slits themselves. Okay, now, on the far wall is the screen, as it's just generically called. The screen was the whiteboard itself when I did the experiment as a demonstration. The slits themselves are on the ring stand there in the back of the room. This distance right here is also an experimental control. It's called L. Okay, L is gigantic compared to small d. Small d is usually less than a millimeter. The distance L goes from the ring stand in the back of the room to here to the front whiteboard. So L is gigantic compared to D. Okay, and then you actually have the interference pattern itself. You have the fringes forming in the following way. They're right here on the wall. So first of all, you get that bright spot, that bright, bright fringe right there at the center. This is referred to as the central maximum. And then, immediately adjacent to that on either side is the first dark fringe. But then after that is the next maximum, the next bright fringe, like so. And then next to that, the next dark fringe. After that, the next bright fringe, like so, and so on. Okay, the reason why, by the way, the pattern gets dimmer and dimmer the further you get from the central maximum is twofold. Number one, first of all, I'm not using a lot of light here in the demonstration. That's why I had to make the room really dark in order for you to be able to see it. And then secondly, as you get further and further away from the central maximum on either side, you're getting further from the slits themselves. So the light gets dim very simply for that reason as well. Okay, now usually what we're interested in, experiment-wise, is to understand the condition necessary at some point on the screen, call it point P, for example, to understand what has to happen there such that we end up with a node or an antinode. I'll get to that, however, in just a few minutes. Before I do, one more definition. We define an angle here on this diagram, call it theta. As we'll see a little bit later on, the angle theta is really tiny. Theta is very small. This will allow us to make a small angle approximation a little bit later on. Okay, then one more distance here on this diagram. The distance that point P is here on the screen from the center of the central maximum, this distance right here is usually referred to as Y, and it's something that's measured. Okay, mathematically, let's note here immediately, by the way, that the tangent of theta is equal to Y over L. We'll need this in just a few minutes. Okay, now we take a look at the two conditions that we're interested in. What is the condition necessary at point P to get a bright fringe? So condition necessary to obtain an antinode at point P. So an antinode in this context, as I said, is referred to as a bright fringe. Well, it turns out we actually already know what that condition is because we looked at it briefly when talking about the two-source interference pattern and the ripple tank. In this context, however, we have to kind of think of it now like this. So here are, once again, my two slits. Slit number one, or source number one, and slit number two, source number two. And then here is, once again, this axis with the distance L. Right here is our screen. Okay, now, slit number one is some distance away from, say, point P here on the screen. As we did with the ripple tank pattern, let's call that distance R1. Okay, and then slit number two, source number two, say, is a slightly different distance away from point P. Let's call this R2. And then on the diagram, I'm going to draw the following dotted line like so, such that now this distance here and this distance here are the same thing. This then means that this distance here, the path length difference, is the difference between R2 and R1, or as referred to as delta R. Okay, now, in order to get a bright fringe, an antinode at point P, the following has to happen. So imagine, for example, coming out of slit number one, we have a sine curve, like so. At the exact same time, coming from this point right here, we would have to have another sine curve, like so. such that those two sine curves then travel the same distance in the same amount of time, arrive at point P together in phase to constructively interfere, to produce a bright fringe. That's only going to happen if in this space here, you have one wavelength, or two wavelengths, or three wavelengths, and so on. So the condition necessary to get a bright fringe at point P, an antinode, is that in space delta R, we have to have a multiple of wavelengths. Now, finding the value of N, by the way, sometimes called the order number, is really easy to do. Because, for example, first of all, if N is equal to zero, this means that delta R is at zero, and then therefore we're just talking about the central maximum. In other words, for this guy right here, the distance R1 and the distance R2 are the exact same thing. And then for the next order, the first order bright fringe here or here, that's just N equals one. So figuring out what the order number is, as it's called, the letter N, is really easy to do. All you gotta do is just literally look at the pattern. But in order to be able to find the wavelength lambda, we need to know the path length difference. So how do you get the delta R? How do we get the path length difference? Well, let's kind of just briefly here blow up this portion of the diagram. Let's just look at what's happening right there. Here's the L like so and the D, blah, blah, blah. And now take a look at these two green lines for R1 and for R2. This guy like so is going off towards point P. This guy like so is going off towards point P. And then let me also draw the line from the diagram up on the top board. Like so. Because L is gigantic compared to D, what could you say geometrically about these three green lines? They're approximately what? Remember that L is huge compared to D. So direction-wise, what could you say about these three green lines? Yeah, they're parallel. They're basically parallel lines. Because once again, L is gigantic compared to D. Okay, now watch what then happens if I drop in the dotted line to form the path length difference. Because the three green lines are basically parallel to each other, this right here is a right angle. And then right here is a little tiny right triangle. Now on that right triangle, we actually know one thing already, and that's the hypotenuse of the triangle D. Right here is what we want to get. This right here is the path length difference. We can find that path length difference by noting the following. The angle theta from the diagram up on the top board, which is this guy right here, is actually the same thing as this angle right here. If you futz around with the geometry appropriately, you can show that this angle here is actually the same thing as this guy right here. So what you end up with right here is a little tiny right triangle, and now I just write down the sine of that angle theta. So the sine of the angle is equal to the opposite side of the triangle, delta R, divided by the hypotenuse. Just cross multiply now and solve for delta R. D sine theta. This is now where the small angle approximation that I briefly mentioned earlier, this is now where it comes in. Remember that when the angle is small, the tangent of the angle and the sine of the angle are basically the same thing. So the sine of theta over there on the right-hand board is the same thing as y over l. This. So if I now take that expression for the path length difference and then go back to my bright fringe expression right here, the equation now becomes the following. And then here's how the equation works. You'll actually use this expression when you do Young's experiment yourself a few weeks from now. Okay, L and D are experimental controls. You control how far apart the slits are. You control how far away your screen is from the slits. And then Y, from the top board, is something that is measured. You then just simply look at the pattern to figure out what the value of N is. And then therefore, if you know this number along with everything else, the only other one is the wavelength of light. So you can then very easily measure the wavelength of light using this expression. It basically works the exact same way for the nodes, for the dark fringes as well. That's drawn out the following way. So now briefly here, condition necessary for a node, which in this context is called a dark fringe. It's like something out of Star Wars. Once again, I like P. Well, we went through this condition back briefly when talking about two-source interference. In this context, however, let me draw it out in the following way. Here's the basic diagram. The basic diagram is always drawn the same way. Source 1 and source 2. Okay, then we have our two directions. So we've got R1 like so to point P, and we've got R2 like so to point P. And then right here, once again, is our little path length difference, right so, delta R. Okay, now in order for you to have a dark fringe, no light at all, at node at point P, then the following has to happen. So for example, once again, let's picture a sine curve like so coming out of S1. At the exact same time then, coming from this point right here, would have to be a negative sine curve like so. It's pi radians out of phase with respect to the first. So then, these two waves right here would travel the same distance and the same amount of time, arrive at point P together, but they would be pi radians out of phase with respect to each other. Yes?
What is dy?
Okay, so the dy over L came basically from this little triangle right here. So the delta R itself, first of all, is just d sine theta. That's this. But the sine of theta from the top order, remember, is basically the same thing as the tangent of theta. It's just y over L. So the path length difference is dy over L, where d and L are experimental controls, and y is just measured on the pattern itself. Okay, we'll use that again here in just a few moments with the dark fringe expression. Okay, but now, once again, for dark fringes here, these guys here basically have to cancel each other out. They're pi radians out of phase. So then, therefore, in this space right here, you would have to have either a half a wavelength, or 1.5 wavelengths, or 2.5 wavelengths, etc., etc. So you have odd multiples of half wavelengths in this space delta R. So the dark fringe equation is written like so, with an odd multiplier. Once again, however, the path length difference is the same thing as it is over on the right-hand board. It's still just dy over L. So alternatively, if we wanted to, we could use the dark fringe equation once again to figure out what the wavelength of the light is. D and the L are experimental controls. The Y is measured. You just figure out what the N is by looking at the pattern, and then therefore the only unknown is the wavelength. Okay, now Young's experiment is basically just one problem, so we'll take a look at a basic problem associated with it to begin with, and this will just give you an idea as to why the pattern looks the way it does. That's this guy here. Now the numbers that I have here in this example, they correspond to the demonstration that you saw. So we're going to understand here why the pattern looks the way it does in parts A and B. We'll also see in part C, lastly, exactly how small the angles are that are in play, if you will, in this situation. Okay, now the laser has a wavelength of 633 nm. Anybody know what NM stands for?
Nanometer.
That's right, it's a nanometer. Does anybody know how many nanometers make up a meter? Yes, Jacob?
1 × 10⁻⁹.
Well, you got it kind of backwards. 1 nanometer is 1/1,000,000th of a meter. Or alternatively, there are 1 billion nanometers in a meter. The wavelength of visible light is exceedingly small. It's in the range of just a few hundred nanometers. The top end of that range, the red portion of Roy G. Biv, that corresponds to a wavelength of about 700 nanometers. But then for violet light, at the short end, if you will, of the Roy G. Biv, that corresponds to a wavelength of around 400 nanometers. So the total window of the electromagnetic spectrum that we can see is only a few hundred nanometers wide, from violet light at one side to red light on the other. Incidentally, while you're copying down this problem and starting to write it out here on the board, let me demonstrate the Roy G. Biv to you in the following way. I meant to do this earlier, I just forgot. What I'm going to have you do in just a moment is take one of these prisms. I'll pass one out per row. And when the prism comes to you, hold it up to your eye in the following manner and look at the ceiling lights. The ceiling lights emit light throughout the Roy G. Biv portion of the visible portion of the electromagnetic spectrum. It has to do with the temperature of the atoms inside the ballast, for example, that make up the lights themselves. So when you look through the prism at the light, you'll be able to see the entire Roy G. Biv. Now, all of that light from the ceiling lights is also reflecting off of everything here in this room. So if you just look around the room at the light reflecting off of everybody, I'm looking at Erin's white t-shirt right now, I can very easily see the Roy G. Biv reflecting off of her t-shirt as well. So take a look at that. And by the way, exactly how prisms work and how it leads to a very famous album cover, we'll get to that a little bit later on. But for now, just take a look at the Roy G. Biv. I still have a first edition pressing of that album in vinyl. Okay, getting back to the problem here at hand. Let me do a little bit of erasing up here. So do you see the Roy G. Biv colors?
Yeah.
That's what you're supposed to
see.
Yeah. Okay, first of all, we have the relevant distances in this problem. What you'll find is that the Young's experiment examples are all really easy, but you just have to remember that everything has to be in the right units. So first of all, the distance D. The distance D here is given as a half a millimeter. However, we do have to convert everything, in this case from millimeters, to meters. So there are 1,000 millimeters in a meter. This means that the distance D is 0.5 times 10 to the minus 3 meters. And then we have the wavelength of the light, lambda. This is, by the way, the wavelength of the light emitted by the laser is 633 nanometers. However, we once again have to convert. We have to convert from nanometers to meters. There are 1 billion nanometers in a meter. So therefore, this is 633 times 10 to the minus 9 meters. And then lastly is the distance L. The distance L goes from the ring stand in the back of the room to the whiteboard here in the front of the classroom. That distance L is about 7 meters. So, and now here's what we're asked to find in part A of the problem. Let's say that we take a look at this bright fringe right here, and it has a value of n associated with it. Okay, that bright fringe is some distance away from the central maximum. Let's call this distance here y sub n. Okay, and then right here is the next bright fringe over. We don't know what this value of n is necessarily, but we do know that it's right next to this guy. So then therefore, if I call this one n, this one here has to be an n plus 1. Okay, that bright fringe is some distance away from the central maximum. Let's say some distance right here. Let's call that y sub n plus 1. Basically, what the question is asking is how far apart are the fringes? It's asking for the value of y associated with the n plus 1 fringe minus the value of y associated with the n fringe. So here's then how we go about solving it. I have to use my bright fringe equation. The bright fringe equation is this expression here. What I'm going to do very simply is just cross multiply some terms here and solve for y. I'll do so when n is this value. And then I'll do the same thing when n is increased to n plus 1. And then I'll just take the two values of y and subtract them from each other. So here's then how that goes. So just take the expression and cross multiply the L and the D to the other side to solve for Y. And when I do, I obtain this, like so. And think of this as the Y for the nth fringe. And then I just do the same thing, but I now replace the N with the N plus 1 fringe. So the y equation then for the n plus 1 fringe would then therefore look like this. And now I just subtract one from the other to get the distance between the fringes. Like so. That distance, by the way, is sometimes just referred to as delta y. So I take this expression here, like so, and then subtract from it this expression here. Like so. And notice how the math here starts to work out. Again, first of all, if I start to do the multiplication, n times L lambda over D, but then minus n L lambda over D, which drops out. And then all that's left is 1 times L lambda over D, we obtain this. These numbers are constants for the experiment. They don't change. So this simply means then that all the bright fringes are evenly spaced. That's exactly what you saw on the pattern itself. And now let me just calculate the number. When I do, remember that everything has to be in the right units. So L, first of all, is 7 meters, and then multiply by lambda, so times 633 times 10 to the minus 9, and then divide by D, divide by 0.5 times 10 to the minus 3, and you end up with a number which is basically what you saw here on the whiteboard. It's about a centimeter. So all the bright fringes were about 1 centimeter apart here on the board. That's basically exactly what you saw. Now, should be the exact same thing for the dark fringes as well. And it is. But showing that from the expression with the dark fringe equation, that's a little trickier. But here's then how that works out. I'm going to give myself some space here. Take a look at a dark fringe here in between these two bright fringes. There's some value of n associated with it. This dark fringe here is some distance away from the central maximum, a y sub n. And then here's the next dark fringe, like so. This guy here is an n plus 1. It's some distance away from the center of the central maximum. Once again, call that y sub n plus 1. Like in part A of the problem here, what we're trying to find is the difference between the two. In order to do so, however, in this case, we have to use the rather tricky dark fringe expression, which is this guy here. And so now what I'll do first is take the expression, solve it for y. I'll cross multiply the L and the D to the other side, and then I'll write the expression for an n, and then similarly for an n plus 1, and then just subtract the 2. Watch what happens as I do. Okay, I'm going to kind of isolate this here from what I'm doing. But first of all, I'm going to take the top expression and just solve it for y. So move the L and the D appropriately to the other side. Like so. Now this is for the nth fringe. Let's see what happens for the next fringe over. Plus 1 fringe. Now when I write this, however, I have to replace the n here with an n plus 1. Be a little bit careful when doing this the first time. So. Okay, take a look at that carefully. If you now simplify what's in these big parentheses here, notice it's 2n plus 3. Now to get the spacing of the dark fringes, take this here and subtract it from this. I'll do this on the front board. So once again, I'm calculating here a delta y. And that then looks like this. First of all, the one with the 3 in it, subtract then this guy here. I'll do this one in a couple of steps so you can see exactly what happens. This is a little trick for the first time you see it. So Okay, so doing the multiplication, we get 2n times blah, 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 minus 2n times blah, 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 which drops out. And then I get a 3 times blah, 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 minus 1 times blah, blah, blah. Like so. 3 minus 1 is 2. So 2 blah, blah, blah. Like so. And then lastly, notice that the 2's cancel. So, and then you get this. It's the exact same thing as this. No surprise. As you saw, the pattern is entirely symmetrical. So the dark fringes are always the same distance apart. Well, about a centimeter. So when you looked at the pattern, the bright fringes, the center of each was about a centimeter apart, and then in between that, the dark fringes, the center of piece, those were about a centimeter apart, just from one side of the diagram. Yep, easy enough. Okay, part C, just to give you a basic idea here of the angles involved, as I said earlier, let's just briefly find one of the angles. It's easy to do. Okay, kind of clean this up here. Good. Okay, as it says in the problem here, let's just take a look at this first bright fringe right there on this side of the central maximum. And then right here is the distance between the two, the delta y that we found earlier, of just 0.009 meters. Okay, the angle that is asked for here in part two of the problem is this opening angle that I drew here on the board a little while ago, this angle here, theta. And we can find it, of course, by just doing a little bit of tangent. Remember that L here is known, it's 7 meters. So tangent of theta is equal to opposite over adjacent. This is all done, by the way, in terms of degree mode on our calculator. Just making sure of that. And now inverse tangent of 0.009 divided by 7. This is obviously very small. The angle itself is only like 0.08 degrees. It's exceedingly tiny. The reason why a lot of these numbers are tiny is because the wavelength of visible light, which is determined by this, is tiny, only in the range of a few nanometers. Now, as we start to move towards the end of the period here, let me show you yet another example of Young's experiment and a couple of other interference effects that you can see all around you if you take the time to look. Interference patterns occur all over the place, but they're usually very subtle. You have to look for them. Here's one example of it. Okay, what I'm going to have everybody do in a few minutes is take a look at one of these light bulbs. So, and then the first thing that we'll do here is we'll look at the red light. When you use the red filter paper here to look at the red light, all of the other wavelengths of the Roy G. Biv are absorbed by the paper except for the red light. The red light transmits through. And then right here is this Cornell plate. One of these plates that has these arrangements of double slits. When the Cornell plate comes to you, you'll notice that there's a manufacturer's insignia in one corner of the plate. And then going downwards from the insignia are a series of double slit arrangements. On the rest of the plate, there are other types of slit arrangements, single slits and multiple slits. We're not concerned with that, only the double slits. And then what you do is you face the light bulb towards you with the red filter paper. Take the Cornell plate then and hold the double slit up to your eye as I'm doing here, and then look at the filament of the light bulb. When you do, you're going to see an alternating pattern of nodes and antinodes in the shape of the filament itself, symmetrically on either side of the filament. So it's Young's experiment once again. Incidentally, by the way, where is the screen in the experiment if you're doing this? Where's the screen?
The cornea of the light bulb.
It's the back of your eyeball. It's the retina. That's where the interference pattern forms. Okay, then switch to the blue filter paper. When you look at the light through the blue filter paper, you're looking at only blue light. Everything else is absorbed by the paper itself, except for the blue light. The blue light, however, has a much smaller wavelength than the red light. So when you look at the pattern of nodes and antinodes as I'm doing here, number one, they're a lot dimmer. They're not as noticeable in the red light. But they're also a lot closer together. So they're a little bit more subtle to see. So look at the red first, which is obvious. and then look at the blue, you'll see the fringes with the blue much closer together. And then lastly, look at the white light itself. When you look at the white light, you're looking at the entire Roy G. Biv. When you look at the entire Roy G. Biv, you'll see the exact same pattern, nodes and antinodes, but if you look carefully, it's very subtle, you can actually see the colors of the Roy G. Biv associated with the fringes themselves. And then lastly, I said a few minutes ago, the interference patterns are around you all the time, but they're very subtle. You have to know how to look. Here's an easy way that right now, sitting at your desk, everybody can see an interference pattern. Do the following. Look at the light bulb right now and squint, just like I'm doing as you do. Look at it carefully. Do you see an alternating pattern of nodes and antinodes going outwards from the filament of the light bulb?
Oh my God.
Absolutely you do. Where are the slits in this case? What are the slits? Your eyelashes. That's right. Your eyelashes act as the slits. And then if you squint at the light bulb as I'm doing now, you could see the alternating pattern of nodes and antinodes. Interference patterns are around you all the time. You just have to know where to look. This is one example of it. Okay, so here's then how I'll do this as a demonstration. And then I have a problem as a follow-up for us to take a look at. What I want each person at this desk to do in just a moment is go to the back rail, grab one of the light bulbs, and grab a Cornell plate. And then everybody at this desk will have a chance to look at the multiple patterns as I've described. Same thing over here. Those of you in these desks, take one person, go to the back rail, grab a light bulb, grab a Cornell plate. Let the people also here on the side desks examine the pattern as well. And then after everybody's had a chance to look at the pattern at your table, pass the materials over here to the middle so the students at the middle desks have a chance to look at that as well. While we're doing this, I'll put the last problem, which has to do with this version of the demonstration, here on the screen, and then we'll quickly look at it. Okay, I'll turn one light off for now, I'll turn the second light off. While you're waiting, especially those of you in the middle, go ahead and squint again and look at the light bulbs. You'll see the interference pattern. If you look at it carefully, you can even see the Roy G. Biv through your eyelashes. And while you're waiting for the light bulb and the Cornell plate to come to you, or after you get a chance to look, go ahead and copy down the following examples. This has to do with the white light version of this demo. So look at the red light first, that's the easiest to see. The blue light is a lot more subtle because with the shorter wavelength, the pattern is tighter. And then lastly, look at the white light. Make sure that everybody at the tables, including the end tables, has a chance to look. Okay, so on the Cornell plate, there's a manufacturer's insignia in one corner, see that? Okay, then going down from the insignia, those are the double slits. Hold it right up to your eye like you saw me do. There you go. Look through one of the double slits. You can change from one slit or angle to the other if you like.
What do I do with this again?
Okay, so do you see the manufacturer's insignia in one corner? One corner of the plate. There's a little insignia. There you go. Okay, then going down from there are the double slits. So just hold it up to your eye and then first look at the red light. See the nodes and antinodes?
No.
Okay, so in the shape of the filament of the light bulb, do you see what appears to be squiggled lines?
Yeah.
Those are nodes and antinodes.
Squiggled lines?
I can only explain this so many ways.
Which slit do you see the red one? Under the?
So underneath the manufacturer's insignia.
I see the same thing, but.
Two lines down or three lines?
Good. Choose one. So look for the red light first, which is usually very easy to see. Then try the blue, which is a lot more subtle. And then lastly, the white light. When you look at the white light, you should notice the entire Roy G. Biv associated with the fringes. But it's subtle.
Oh,
bunch of curved lines right at the bottom of the light, so.
That's it.
Yeah, oh, I see.
And then this last example here, it corresponds to what you're seeing when you're looking at the light bulb. Julian, do you see it?
Yeah.
Anyway, I always get a couple of kids here. So look at the red light. Look at that first. Do you see what appears to be stripes?
Stripes, yes.
There you go. Those are the nodes and the antinodes. Oh. I'm going to turn on one of the ceiling lights. After everybody at your table has had a chance to look, after everybody in the middle tables has had a chance to look, unplug the light bulbs so they can cool down. Pippa, you need to rotate that 90 degrees. Do you see now the manufacturer's insignia?
Where did you see
that? Open your eyes and see the world, kids. There's a lot to see.
On the board.
All right, take a moment to copy down the problem if you haven't already done so.
Right. I'll see it.
Can you see the squiggle lines, Michael?
Yeah.
There you go. Those are the notes and antinodes.
Sounds like a term.
And yeah, you can form the slits with your eyelashes. Have you ever squinted out in bright sunlight and you're like, oh, I see colors?
No.
I'm seeing interference patterns.
I see the sun. All right,
let's work through the example here to finish off. Quiet down, please. Remember my handout for you at the beginning of the period. Okay, so multicolored light, just two wavelengths, keep it easy. Consisting of two wavelengths, 480 nanometers and 630 nanometers respectively. 480 is the blue, 630 is the red. Okay, both of those colors at the same time are incident upon a double slit arrangement. Once again, we'll say that the slit separation is a half a millimeter. Okay, then the screen where the fringes form, that's your retina, which is about 2.5 centimeters behind the front of your eye. So how far apart are the bright fringes, the red and the blue, or just simply n equals 1? Okay, once again, we've got some numbers here, first of all. Okay, so first of all, the wavelength of the red light. Again, that's 630 nanometers. Once again, however, we have to convert to meters. That's a very common mistake to make, by the way, when you do some basic Young's experiment problems. You forget to convert. Everything has to be in the same units. So 630 times 10 to the minus 9 meters. Okay, and then we've got our wavelength here for the blue light, lambda blue. Okay, that's what, 480? So 480 nanometers. Once again, we have to convert. This is 480 times 10 to the minus 9. Okay, then we have our distance D here, the slit separation. So the distance D is given to us as half a millimeter. And once again, you got to convert to meters. This is 0.5 times 10 to the minus 3 meters. Okay, and lastly, if this is the front of your eye where the slits are, and then here's your retina, like so, the distance L here is 2.5 centimeters. Once again, we do have to convert that, however, into meters. It's 2.5 times 10 to the minus 2 meters. Okay, now here's basically what's being asked. Notice that I've drawn two patterns here on my screen. So the central maxima of both blue and red overlap each other. And then because the wavelength of the blue light is smaller than that of the red light, we see the blue fringes first. So right here is the n equals 1 blue fringe, and it's some distance away from the central maxima. We'll just call it y blue. Okay, then immediately next to that, they're basically on top of each other, but next to that, right here is the n equals 1 red fringe. Like so. It's some distance away from the central maximum, call it y red. So kind of like the first example that I did a little while ago, basically in this problem we're trying to find the difference in the y's. We're going to find y red minus y blue. Basically these guys are really close together. Okay, now this is just a bright fringe problem. The bright fringe equation is usually very easy to work with, and that's the following expression, dy over l equals n lambda. What I'm going to do, once again, is cross multiply here and solve for y, but I'm going to set the n equal to 1 as I do. I'll then write the expression for y red, write it for y blue, and then just subtract the two from the top. So first of all, cross multiplying here and just solving first of all for y. Once again, I'm going to set the n equal to 1 when I do. So just move the l and the d to the other side, and then y in the following expression. So, okay, once again, I set the n there equal to 1. So this then means that for the red light, y red is l lambda red over d. And then for the blue light, call it y blue. Blue is equal to L lambda blue over D. Oops, over D, not 2. Like so, and now you just subtract that from the other. So Y red minus Y blue to finish equals, first of all, this here minus this. The L and the D is common to both, so I'll just factor it out. So, you just have the following in parentheses. And then when I plug the numbers in the parentheses, by the way, is basically just 630 minus 480, which is 150 nanometers. So this right here is just 150 times 10 to the minus 9 meters. Then I'm going to multiply by L and D, and I'll get a distance here between the fringes in terms of meters. It's exceedingly tiny. So finishing up, let's see, first of all, L, 2.5 times 10 to the minus 2, okay, divide by D, 2.5 times 10 to the minus 3, and then multiply by the difference in the wavelengths, 150 nanometers, so times 150 times 10 to the minus 9. This comes out to be 7.5 times 10 to the minus 6 meters. That's 7.5 microns, 7.5 billionths of a meter. So because the wavelength of visible light is so small, and even though we're talking about a window here from blue to red that's a few hundred nanometers wide, basically the patterns are so close to each other that they're all on top of each other. They're all basically interfering with each other, which is why you saw very nicely well-defined bright and dark fringes for the white light. But how many of you noticed a little bit of the Roy G. Biv associated with those fringes? You're basically starting to see this tiny distance there when you look at the pattern. Okay, take a look here at the agenda board. Okay, there is, believe it or not, a very short three-problem web assignment that is due tomorrow. It's based upon today's lecture. It's Young's experiment. There's nothing to it. However, we're starting to jump around in class. It's chapter 34. What I would ask you to do, keep this in mind, what I would ask you to do is to read the first couple of sections of chapter 34 as well. I outlined that for you in the schedule. Okay? All right, Brian, I'm rolling. Oh, like here's a chart.
No red. Red.
Oh, yeah, I had one too.
You love us, right?
Calvin, yeah.
No, but just doing the poem.
I always text you at like 3 in the morning. Two nights ago, I was like so tripped out by that.
It says on the instructions not to.
Okay, it says not to. It says do extra.
He was?
So the only problem is you're going to have to
why are you failing your classes?
Because you are a conductor, when she places her hand on the generator and the generator charges up, she charges up as well. Believe it, she's a conductor. I had her stand on this file folder, such as she is not grounded. So she's isolated. I think it's something else. So the metaphor of charge.
Huh? All right, it's still going.